I will not go into literature on those kind of things, but the issues that come to my mind. There's this whole question of publicness of the institutions, which I think is very important when we look at the issues of public-private partnerships and the role of private sector, because there are national goals, mission and vision, and the constitutional mandate, and to what extent these public-private partnerships are being able to address that constitutional mandate. In the previous literature review in both higher education as well as school education, there are ample evidences or indications where the private provider is unable to address those national goals, mission and vision. In fact, with the current political scenario in the country, talking about national goals or national mandate also becomes problematic, which we need to problematize. And to what extent, in what ways, the private sector participates in defining, the civic participation, democratic mandate in the institutions. Also, this whole conflict between the interpretation of rights as consumers. If you are paying, then you have to get value for money. But at the same time, if you are a private provider, so if you are investing, then you need something out of that interaction. So rights as consumer investors, and when they come into conflict with rights as citizens. So if we every citizen, and with the right to education in India since 2009 Act, every child has to get has equal right to access to education. However, in terms of we see voices of the private providers asking for relaxations in terms of the, for example, regulations or the norms for the setting up of schools. So private providers are unable to address those norms in terms of teacher qualifications, and therefore they are asking for some kind of relief in terms of the easing out of those regulations. Then in terms of the stakeholders, the issue of direct and indirect stakeholders. Yesterday we had presentations on environment, and where environment itself is an indirect stakeholder. People work to maintain the environment and for themselves, but environment does not come itself and ask for that. So in terms of the direct, indirect stakeholders, and for example, in my study, I find that yes, the PPPs are being, and these multi-stakeholder partnerships are being organized at the level of the state. State has interest, it invites, or the private providers have interest, they approach the government, and then they become collaborators. But the previous model of communities coming together, forming voice groups, asking state to deliver, those are getting marginalized. So this whole issue of indirect, direct stakeholders in the PPPs. Then PPPs as innovations have been, most of the innovations we know in research and development, these are investment intensive experiments. They may succeed, they may not succeed. But in case of education, there's a whole question of whether we can leave it at the stage of experimentation, and what do we learn out of these experiments? Because whenever the evaluation of these innovations occur, they are mostly sponsored evaluations. So there are no independent academic researchers. Mine would be kind of looked at the program, asking questions of program evaluation. However, there are not many such studies which are independent. Many studies go and talk only to the major experts, deemed experts, but they do not get into independent evaluation, and they may not succeed. In terms of resource gaps, it's a misnomer that the private participation is there to fill the resource gap. In fact, the evidence till now all over has suggested that the public resources are being channeled into the private sector. They end up, even when there are philanthropic interventions, partnerships, and in this program, the multi-stakeholder partnership that I studied, where government was not paying any of the providers. These providers were coming and working in the government school, but ultimately these were seen as kind of initiatives where the providers will get some return on some other forum. For example, if a bank comes and works in the education sector, but this is the same bank which acquires a public sector bank later on in the state. So these are not the why so many providers are interested, because it's a very good rapport building channel for, with the government officials. Alright. So the public accountability of public-private partnerships is a very big question, and especially the kind of partnership that I study, the multi-stakeholder partnership, which is philanthropic in nature, it's much more questionable because the providers, they enter at their own whims and fancies even when they sign the MOUs with the government, because the government is not paying them, so they take the use it as kind of, you know, lab. Whether for the ICT companies, use of their materials that they develop. So public accountability remains a big question. And the can the benefits of PPP be realized in the absence of state as regulator? Because there's whole Petronas and others have looked at saying that state is very important. But also the question is, what is the role of these various state linked institutions in furthering the agenda of the private sector or pushing the government and the public space into privatization. And a very good example, and there are studies in school education, one pointed out towards the how the courts become facilitator. Mm-hmm. You know, if you look at that the World Bank program started in India in 1990s, and the first the World Bank funded program started in Madhya Pradesh, looking at starting small schools. Many Shiksha Mitra or the para teachers were appointed, para teachers program was appointed. And then after a long period of time, these teachers went to the courts. The courts always snubbed those teachers. But later on in 2010, a World Bank report itself says that courts should take a lenient view and they should not be very harsh on teachers. So with the changing policies of these international banks and organizations, the voice and the way the courts respond to those pressures and to the policies of the government, that also changes. Close monitoring versus absence of state in multi-stakeholder partnerships, this remains a very big issue because multi-stakeholder partnerships are also considered in a way self-regulatory, but we know there are unequal power relations. In my work, I have used Andrew Sayre's model of, you know, geographies of power, looking at how there are causal powers and susceptibilities in these power relations. And therefore, too close monitoring would stifle any kind of partnership, even within with equal power relation. Within these two extremes, there are spaces of regulation. Public obligation versus financial gain motive. As I said that in the MS multi-stakeholder partnership model that I studied, many providers had entered the space with the intention, the stated intention of being trying to support the government in a philanthropic initiative, in a MSP thing. However, if they do not find any gain in their main area of activity, they would simply exit the space without any. So this whole debate between public obligation versus financial gain motive. Also, I think Harsimrat mentioned about that the government is not opening many schools because, again, they feels that there are private players in the area. But however, if it's not lucrative enough for the private spaces, private players, they will not open the schools. At the same time, the government is closing down. More than 14,000 schools were closed down recently, 2 years ago in Rajasthan. So the merged or closed down. So This I've already touched upon. How do the PPPs impact the overall resource base? Is there any change? This is the question we need to ask. Then this whole question of accountability. In my study, I've asked these questions, looked at the accountability from these points, that usually it's considered that whenever there are formalized partnerships, there is more accountability. So formalization in terms of the MOUs, saying what would be the stated outcomes is very important. However, it is very difficult to find, we do not know how do partners ensure downward accountability. So if they might seem accountable, they might be giving a lot of data to the government if they enter into partnership, or to their counterparts. However, if they are really accountable to the children or the schools or teachers they work with, how is accountability ensured when multiple actors work within the same constituency? There are so many linkages happening with people or organizations we had known are there for a very different reasons. So now we find Teach India program, for example, in the space. At the same time, there are very traditional grassroots organizations, and then they have to collaborate with each other. With funding restrictions on the organizations, they have to sustain themselves, their people. There is also movement of people from these organizations to these corporate organizations. So this whole movement of people and how they work in the same constituencies, there are issues of so many compromises, or the vocabulary is also traveling alongside. The gap between the degree of formality as reported and that in the actual practice, the lack of or the delay in the communication cycle from the government to the lower levels in the hierarchy of organizations. Sometimes, even when there are formalized MOUs, there are stated aims, those outcomes cannot be tested because someone has to take action, has to monitor it very closely, and when there is much delay, the partners lose interest or there's no monitoring really. And the differential capacity with regard to resource power, capitalist, and a certain technological power of business houses, capacity to work closely with poor, so they are not equal. Communities, the organizations who have capacity to work with the communities, and they know the issues of the communities, they have long experience of working in education, vis-a-vis someone who claims that they have better managerial capacity. So these may come into conflict with each other, and they impact on the nature and quality of formality, and hence the accountability. Drexler, I think one pointed out to Alexander Drexler's work, and this is looking at the MSPs, that they've compromised on the values of democracy, transparency, and labor laws. We know how in PPPs, in name of the cost efficiency, low-paid teachers or the labor force, not only teachers, but other educators and other education workforce has been linked to these organizations. And there is no job security after that. If the PPPs, they vanish, but the rights of the workers, there's a whole issue. Then unequal powers of partners, and this pretense that power is not an issue, but it's a big thing in how they are linked. Issues of efficiency, accountability, and strategic reshaping and reformulation of the private sector. This is what I think, that because of this issues of efficiency, there's a very strategic reshaping in terms of bringing in the terminologies and the indicators of efficiency into the system in terms of assessments, in terms of testings and all. Also in terms of short-term immediate outcomes and long-term gains. In the MSPs that I study, and when the PPPs are for a limited period of time, the exit route of these partnerships, of the transfers, transformation and transition, they are not really focused upon during the formation of the or formalization of these partnerships. The innovate or experimental models that can be scaled up. So scaling up is largely missing. though I understand that there's also the debate on contextualization, you know, so that has to be also kept side by side. But however, the sustainability again, so then CSR is largely seen as an investment by the partners. In school education, my study also sees that there is a reproduction of curriculum in the name of efficiency. So there are schools which have managers, and these managers in the school adoption program I looked at who are men, and we talked to them why these men are school managers. So they say because the community members have to come, and most of them are men, and men are better managers. So these kinds of, you know, these parallelisms are also, and so there are no voices, no one to look at those issues. Openness to PPP initiatives. So if there is a government official, and a mostly male government official who were officer who was who approved for the ICT initiatives or the private partnerships initiatives with ICTs, and was followed later on replaced by a woman officer who was not in favor of PPPs in general at that time, or had her own arguments. So the working officials, with her counterparts or other officials would say that being a woman, she has no knowledge of ICT, and therefore, so this whole thing of gender and other curriculums. Similarly, those organizations who are working at the grassroots level also use caste identities in terms of making those connections and, you know, getting the favor of other people in the community, or the taking the government school sides in for the favor of the private sector. And then impressions about technical know-how, I've already pointed out. Adoption of corporate business policies and terminologies, and the notions of efficiency. So this was the whole with partnership transformation across the stage. The stage one, where there's a formation and formalization of partnerships in terms of signing of MOUs, this was very much focused. However, at the stage two, where the operation implementation, which remained loosely monitored, there was not much focus. Being a philanthropic, you know, at-will initiative, not much focus was there. And the stage three was completely neglected. Even there was no, when you talk to the officials or the people who are governing the partnerships, and you're saying that this is a very good partnership. Now, what kind of costs have got into, you know, making this thing happen? And how would you accrue the benefits in the long run? So that kind of intention or attention to that detail is totally absent in terms of, so what will happen in terms of the terminate, how will they terminate? There are clauses, but I did not see any partnership terminating. And then also the involvement, who are the players? Now, World Economic Forum was very much instrumental in initiating this Rajasthan Education Initiative. So if you look at the report of the World Economic Forum, and Bhanji's work was referred to, in Jordan, in Palestine, in other countries, this was done also in India. But working with an imperialist state, you know, and working with a democratic state is a very different experience. So things that were done there, there were demands on the organization, so they could work there. But in case of India, or specifically in the state of Rajasthan, this was the only partnership World Economic Forum had. So they said, we had a hands-off approach. So what does that mean when you are claiming that you have put in so much money into through the ICT-enabled partnerships? What does hands-off approach mean? So the responsibility, and most of the PPPs work on, so this whole issue of whose responsibility is it at the end? When we say state is the regulator, so if the partnership succeeds, that becomes the basis for the private provider to gain more business, you know, more such initiatives, access to more such initiatives. However, if it fails, it is considered as a failure of the state. So there's no collective responsibility in, you know, owning up the failure, that, you know, reflecting on self. So all the providers, in fact, they need to look at that. In higher education, so much has been said by Imam. See, in before 1947, during the period of colonial state in India, the state did not have much role. Now, around 1857, the state started intervening. So all the initiatives were philanthropic, private, by the interest groups, and very elite also in nature. And when the state started intervening, that was not, that colonial state was a capitalist state, in fact. Only post 1947, with the expansion of, you know, the welfare state started functioning, with this whole publicization of higher education through the grant in aid system. Grant in aid system was also there in school education, so the state wanted that control in the education sector through the system. Also, the massification of higher education happened because of the success of the education programs in school education. So EFA, the Education for All program, it led to the push towards the higher education. So the success of these programs led to also demand on the higher education. However, the expansion of the sector in terms of the provisioning of the public institutions was much less. In 90s, with the signing of GATS in the liberalization period and post-liberalization, we saw that there were enough policies at the central level and at the level of the federal states to allow for the expansion of the private sector. So there was unregulated proliferation of institutions and STEM subjects. However, if you look at the case of certain selected Indian states in Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, in many southern states, where there was this proliferation, there was also kind of the unemployment or the unemployability of graduates from this unregulated higher education. That also kind of capped the expansion of because there were no engineering graduates who were getting employment, and later on there were less and less. So more engineering graduates now started moving towards management courses and less to the engineering ones. So that the capitation fed led higher education colleges start shutting down. There's also this in this PPP, where the state, if it's a weak regulator, how within the private sector it regulated itself, because the inefficiencies it kind of promoted led to the killing of the private sector institutions. But it's a very specific kind of case. But the private sector provisioning of higher education is increasing at a very fast pace. The role of state policies in facilitating the spread of private sector involvement. PPPs is an agenda of the state from 1990s, and emphatically so in the 11th plan period, 5-year plan on. So we see the 11th 5-year plan and then the 12th 5-year plan. They worked very elaborately on this agenda of extension of PPPs. At the same time, the arms of state, the allied institution of state in encouraging PPPs and privatization has a very important role. And I would like to here the specify the role of NAC, National Assessment and Accreditation Council, which were, although there is a very limited number of institutions which till now have gone for accreditation, and more so because it was voluntary till the RUSHSA came into effect in 2013. NAC, in all the reports to the institutions, the universities and colleges it has been visiting, if you look at the recommendations that NAC has made, it has been encouraging institutions to forge linkages with the industry, open more market viable courses, have more self-financing courses, and in collaboration with the industry. So they simply, with the use of indicators to calculate the performance scores of the institutions, it is pushing public-private partnerships and privatization as a quality indicator. And I think that's it.